Welcome to the lecture number 24 of the deep learning course. In this session, we are going to talk about two more important concepts into this particular domain. One is SSD and another is a 3D CNNs. So let us discuss one by one when they would come. So in the last class, if you remember that we were talking about that what is the object detection. Okay. So we have seen that if you have an image, and you want to find out that where is the image, so the method that we have seen that there are out of multiple ways that the first thing that we thought that we are going to use a different size, for example, k cross k with the different values of k, I'm going to use a kind of window and I'm going to slide into x and y direction. And with all values of k and all values of sliding possible, I'm going to make a model that is going to be a classifier. And this classifier can tell that out of all the available class, what is the probability that this item is going to be. We have seen that this is not a good idea. Earlier, people have tried this, means it is the first thing that people try. But this is not going to work well. So we have seen that there need to be something done smartly. So one of the method was deformative part model that we have seen. And it was a handcrafted kind of method that was there. So out of various methods that were available, deformative part model was the one of the best models that has a highest accuracy on. There is a database called Pascal on this particular database. And we have seen a very sudden increase into the efficiency when we saw there was a model called RCNN. So this was the first model that we have seen in the last class. That was a very good model. It was having the accuracy of 66%. So it was a very good model. So what this particular model was doing, if you remember, so there was some external agent. So it was telling that let me have some external agent, and this is a region proposal network, sir. And he's somehow, I'm not sure, maybe by randomly picking some of the points and then applying some of the models to come up with the understanding that looks like that there is an item. Then this particular network has been deployed, that given this region proposal that this particular that the outside network is going to give me, I am going to find out that what is the accuracy that there is a thing. So this was a very good, in terms of the accuracy, this was a very excellent algorithm. And mostly the problem was this, that this the outer thing, the external reason proposal network was going to give us 2000 different things. So if we want to find out a object detection, we do an object detection on a single image, we have to run this the same network 2000 times. And therefore, it was very slow. So next network that people had talked about was what called the fast RCNN. In the fast RCNN, what was achieved, that the accuracy was even higher and the speed was actually faster. And then the third one that we actually after that seen was the faster RCNN. And this was an interesting idea that actually tells that why not I also develop a part that can by itself tell that looks like that there are some item. Means the region proposal that was actually outside, it is the part of this particular network itself. So given the image, what happens that given the image, there are two parts of this particular network, faster RCNN. That first portion that actually tells that looks like that there is some item. And the second one actually, find out that actually what is the classification and what is the probability of an item over there, and then we can use that particular part. So I just missed this particular part, that what is the importance into the fast RCNN. So what is the importance into the fast RCNN? Do you remember? So into the here we saw that the region proposal network was there. So region proposal network, for example, this is an image, or let's assume that this is the cat. This is the cat. So it is possible that you can give me this particular bounding box, or you can give me this particular bounding box. So I would tell that there is a cat. Then what I can do, that if I know that there is a cat, I can increase the size so that I can fit to this particular thing. So this improvement, actually, if I do this kind of improvement, what would happen? That I would remove other kind of region proposal from here. Okay. So if external party is going to give me that looks like here is a cat, here is a cat, here is a cat. So if I find out in one place, I can extend it and I can tell that cat is here and I can safely ignore others one. So using this thing, fast RCNN was fast because he was not taking all these things, but there was a regressor that actually increases, expands the things and fits the things onto the image. Here, what is the important thing? That given the image, there are two parts. Now we have two parts. Given the image, there is a two part, and one part is actually by itself trying to say in one shot, because in immediately you can tell. And then the second part immediately can find out that what is the probability that there is an item. Faster RCNN was very good, method. And we can see that there are two implementation that we are actually mentioning over here. One is using ZFNet, another is a VGG16 for the feature extraction. And the VGG16 was actually having the higher accuracy. So therefore, this is only most of the time people, whenever they talk about this architecture, they actually refer to this architecture. So till now, we are into this particular scenario that it is 2016 paper that actually tells that now we can do it is a 7 frames per second. You know that when you see the video, there are nearly 24 frames per second. Frames, when you see a video is an image only. One by one images are going to be displayed to you. In 1 second, 24 images are shown to you. That's why you think that they are not images, they are video. So there was a requirement to increase this particular thing. We have seen also into the last class that the next architecture that the people had thought about was the YOLO. And this is not a very difficult to talk about at this particular level. What I was telling, that given the image, there are two parts, that one gives that where are the regions and another find out what where the classification. This was the thing. So you can develop a strategy, you can by yourself say that if because computation is not a big problem, let's assume that computation is not a big problem, then I can divide the image into the part. For each of the part, I can apply this particular network into the separate way. So this you can think, because well, in one image you can do it. So let's assume the image is bigger. I can divide the image into 7x7, or mostly they have used 7x7. So for everything, if I apply a separate network, how many networks I need? 7x7, 49 different heads. If they are deployed into the system, they can immediately give you the answer. So in the same way, it was this part was giving you one answer, it can give you 7x7 different answers. And likewise, you can increase also. That depends upon your problem and requirement. So you can change the architecture so that you can get more number of available things from there also. So YOLO was a very interesting thing. And as you can see that when you actually, this one part was, YOLO was also this, that whatever image is given to you, you are going to scale that image. So everything becomes fixed kind of, okay? Then you can find out the answer. And accuracy was of this particular YOLO was comparable, but not better, 63.4% only. But the speed was very high, 45 frame per second. So because of this, this becomes a kind of standard, and many other places you see this particular algorithm that has been deployed. Interestingly, that as I mentioned in the last class, when this particular group has actually written the paper at that time, this was the accuracy, but they were working at the time when they presented this paper at CVPR, at that time their accuracy was 66%. We have seen multiple improvements also, V5 and PP, YOLO, and these are the few names that actually came very recently. But interestingly, there was one more very important development, and this was SSD, Single Shot Multi-Box Detector. Today, we are going to see about this. What is the importance of this particular algorithm? The accuracy of this particular model is 94.3%. Means what? That on this particular line where I was increasing the thing, actually it is increasing the accuracy. Okay. And the frame rate is 59 frame per second. So it is way better. I mean, it is better and it is way faster. So this technology, this thing we are going to talk about today. So it also, as we have seen here also, that they are going to use a backbone as a ZFNet or VGG16. So similarly, they are also going to use VGG16 and based on that, whether they are going to, what is the feature size, based on that, there are some versions also, SSD 500, SSD 300. So based on this this accuracy and this frame rate actually changes. Also with respect to training protocol also this changes. But I think this is sufficient to understand that how good this particular thing is. In the both the dimensions, that in terms of the accuracy and in terms of the speed, this particular model is better. Understand? So hope this motivates you well. And now let us try to see that what is an important part. And let me give you some brief idea that comes to my mind whenever I present these kind of things to you. So I always ask that, can you think something that how to improve something? Few minutes back we have talked, and I think you can clearly understand that this is the thing that is missing. Maybe we can do it. Okay, let me tell you what. So there was we have talked about that there was an image. On that image we have done the scaling and we have come up to this particular part. And then what I said, that the same kind of architecture is going to be applied on all these parts, and I'm going to get what? Reason proposals. It is going to give me the probability, and I'm going to get this. So what is the problem? What is the problem with these kind of networks? Only thing that you can think is that, okay, this can find out the object, but what is the size of that particular object? Okay, it may be possible the object is very small. It may be possible the object is very large. If you can apply the same thing on all these things, system would not work good because it is not going to see the things at a different scales. Same kind of improvement we have seen earlier also when initially the people were trying to improve. So why don't we apply the same kind of philosophy here also? See the things at a different scales. Got the idea? So YOLO, actually what happens, YOLO is very good, but it fails to those kind of scenarios where the object is very small or of very different size. Okay, so if we in this particular portion only, when I'm going to find out something, if I see the things at a different scale, I may be better. And I may not be very much better. You can see that it is not very much better, but definitely it is better. So because we should say that it is a better thing. Okay, this is what the SSD is. This is the architecture. Hope it is clear to you. And this is clear to you in terms of the diagram. Can you see it clearly? Okay, no. So let me show you from very high level perspective, then I would go inside and give you the details. Okay, so you need not to understand everything at this particular point. What are the important components? We should only focus on that particular thing. Okay, so you tell me that you understand or not. So here is an image. After that, I have actually applied VGG16 to find out the feature. You know that VGG16 is an architecture. In the VGG16 architecture, there were multiple places where we can take the features. So it is going to take the feature from in between pool 5 layers. At the pool 5 layer, it is going to take the feature. This part is clear? Okay. So this part is clear. Given the image, there is something, VGG16 has been deployed. After that, one feature I'm going to take from inside and one feature I'm going to take from before the fully connected layer, because in this kind of architecture, we have seen that there is a feature extractor, then after that there is a classification head. Before the classification head, whatever the feature is that has been fed to the fully connected, I'm going to use that part only, that part also. These two things I'm going to utilize. Okay. And this part is clear. Let me draw. This you understand and this you understand. Okay, you understand these things? All right. Why don't we apply some kind of CNNs? Because something I have, I can apply CNNs. You would definitely apply some CNNs to find out a better representation of that particular thing. As I'm telling that I want to see the things on the different scales. So why don't you apply again CNN with some stride of 2? Stride is 2 here. I think it is not clear. So stride is 2. So with a stride of 2, if you apply, things become smaller. There is a problem. Whenever we do the things like this, there is a problem, and this is called interlacing. But let's follow. For right now, let's forget about that. But I'm going to see that every alternate pixel I'm going to collect, image becomes smaller. Smaller means what? You are going to see bigger objects. When the image becomes smaller, you try to see that what is the bigger picture. Make it more smaller, again with the same kind of stride 2 at different scale. One more scale. Okay, again, it is going to be smaller. Again, I'm going to make it smaller. So different scales I have actually applied. Make same concept, no problem. Okay. So after that there is a classification head. What is this? As we have talked about, that it is going to propose the region and tell me that what is the class of that particular object. So that part we have seen, that we can move those kind of systems that can make faster RCNN kind of devices, architecture that actually can tell that here is an object and what is its class. For everything, I'm going to apply. This is again a problematic thing, means a special thing that you have to understand. I'm not going to combine these things. I'm going to apply the classification on this, on this, on this, on this, on this separately. So multiple different things are actually there that are going to tell that what is the classification of that particular item. So let's assume there are 20 items in my database. So I say that, no, not 20 items. I have 21 items. What do I mean by this? 20 items are, for example, let's assume that there are 5 items. When I say that, I have to find out the example answer. I become bat. Let's assume there are 3 items, bat, ball, and dog. Let's assume three things are there. I say that, no, I don't have 3. I have 4 things. What is the 4th one? None of these. Okay, none of these. These are the 4 things. So whenever there are, I have the item, I can say that I can add one more to save my computation effect. And I say that there is one more item that none of these. So if my system says that none of these, I can safely just neglect that particular thing. Okay, all right. So in this discussion, you understand. That if I pick any of the line, for example, this particular line, if I pick this particular line, so the system is going to tell me what? Here the classification is going to tell me what? That what is the location? Location, how to specify the location? By XY coordinate, because it is going to be a box only, you tell that what is XY location and what is length and what is breadth. Using this XY plus L plus B, these 4 items, you have to tell me that where is the item and what is the class? What is the class? P, a vector that is of the P size. Let's assume that P number of classes are there. So P size vector that tells me that which particular object I'm going to understand. Looks like that. So there is a head. How many heads I can deploy? Again, the similar kind of mechanism I can apply. So whenever I see this particular thing, you see this into this particular way. Okay, here also, as we have discussed earlier, that you can divide the things into parts, and every head, there are multiple heads. How many heads are there? There are many heads, okay? It is going to take a lot of things. So in this paper, it is telling 8732 number of heads. 8732 number of heads, okay? 8732 number of heads. These many number of heads are there. So every head, so once again, there are 1, 2, 3, 8, 7, 3, 2 number of head. There is other setting also where 1000 something, I think 15,000 something is there. So as I told you that you can change it, okay? Because if you change it, different kind of things are going to come. So every head is actually assigned to a particular location. For this is responsible for this area, this is responsible for this area, this is responsible for this area, so on. So if there is some item over here, so corresponding head is going to tell me that there is an item, and it will give me the actually because when item is here, item may be this particular thing size, na? So it is going to tell me what is XY location and which particular item it is. So different kind of heads are there, not one head. Okay, they are going to see a different part. And each of them are responsible for telling me where is that. They also have one more class that tells that my answer is not important. You can safely neglect my answer. Any questions on this architecture? Any questions? Still now, I think I have told you multiple things. Okay. After that, the things are very simple. Okay. Any questions on that? So what I told you that it is going to happen because we know that in single start, if we want to do, don't want to do the regression. So there should be some mechanism that by itself try to find out. So 8732 number of heads are there, different parts are there. And here for every parts, for every portion, one particular head is going to be important. Clear? Okay. So whenever this particular line only says that whenever I'm going to tell about output, for example, there is a head, it is going to give me output. What is going to tell? Category score. Achha, box offset, we have just talked about the box offset. Box offset is this, that what is XY location, what is length and breadth. Okay, 4 values. Box offset is 4 values. Every regression head is going to give me 4 values. Plus what? Category score. What is the category score? P categories are there, so P dimensional vector is going to be given to me with the corresponding probability, that what is the probability of every item. Clear? All right. So there is one more part, that is a non-maximum suppression. What is non-maximum suppression? So actually what happens now? Let me ask a question from you, and then it would be clear to you. Let's assume I have a very beautiful cat. Okay, nobody would tell that cat is not good. Okay. Anybody have problem? I can only draw like this. Okay. So if I ask you that what is the probability that there is a cat, I'm not sure about this, maybe 0.8. Okay. If I ask what is the probability that there is a cat, what is the probability? 0.6, because it is not going to have much. What is the probability there is a cat? It is also have the white spaces, the probability would be lesser, maybe 0.5. What is the probability there is a cat? The cat to here. The probability would be lesser. Highest probability would be in this particular box, which is going to have this thing. Highest probability would be here. Okay. So if a particular pixel, I see the output that multiple people are telling me that here is a cat, here is a cat, here is a cat, here is a cat. Multiple people are going to tell me here is a cat. So what I would do, I would pick all these. Okay. On this particular pixel, these many number of things are there. Okay. Which has the highest accuracy, highest probability? I would take that one only and neglect all other things. Okay. This is the non-maximal suppression. Who is the non-maximal? At that particular point, whichever things are appearing, anyone that is not maximal at that particular pixel, I'm going to neglect that. Non-maximal suppression. That is nothing more than that. Very simple thing. Yeah.
When you drew the bigger box in which the whole cat was there and a lot of white space was also there, so that box would still give a good probability for the cat, right?
Maybe not. Because other places, other things are also there, right? So he may be not fully sure, because he had been trained on the cat thing. Other things are also there. So there is some probability because many portion of the cat is coming. But other things, whatever background is coming, because of the background, the score would be lesser. Okay? Yeah. So this architecture is clear to everybody? Very simple architecture. Okay? Not a very, very complex kind of architecture. Okay? So we have discussed this particular part, that it does the detection at the various scales. Different scale, it is going to do the things. Aggregate feature at the later layers help detect the large global objects. So what do I mean by this? That whenever you are going to aggregate this, so whenever you are going to come at this particular place, here you are, this particular corresponding thing is going to give you bigger object. A smaller object would be detected over here, because whenever you make the things smaller, so a smaller thing got eradicated, they are deleted. We have also seen that if I have an image and I convolve with the 5x5, what does it mean? Anything that is lesser than 5x5 has been deleted. Okay, so that's why it is very important to have the kernel size right, because if your kernel size is actually greater than your object that you are looking far, then that particular item would be actually deleted. And we have also seen this as an application, that when we wanted to improve the quality of image, we have subtracted the 3x3 part from the original image. There was two parts. Now we have seen that, let's assume that I have an image and I have I 3x3, that is actually 3x3 convoluted thing. So if I find out the difference between these two things, I minus I 3x3, so I got details. By this, I got the detail. If in the original image, if I add this particular detail, the image got enhanced. We have seen earlier, okay? Image would be enhanced, because the smaller thing, which are less than 3x3, they are actually highlighted. So this is, we have discussed. Once again, it is single shot, and it avoids the region proposal or the selective search. I just forgot to mention this particular thing, that this paper appeared in 2016. And till now, it has 17,000 citations. And the paper title is Single Shot Multi-Box Detector in ECCV. That is a very good conference, a European Conference on Computer Vision. It has appeared. So this is the citation. I suggest you that please go and see this particular paper. There are still more details, okay? Still more details. And such as, let me just give you one more detail on this particular paper that is important. So what happens? Let's assume that here is an object, okay, and your network is going to give me this. Okay, your network is going to tell me this. So it's okay, it's not that bad. Okay, let's assume here is an object and your network is going to give me this. So here was, what was the shift? Let's assume that 2 pixel shift was there. What is the shift here? Here also there is a 2 pixel set shift. So in terms of the pixel shift, it is fine. Same, okay, same problem. So if I say that, I am just trying to loosely quantify. Let me see that it is the goodness of this particular thing is G1 and goodness of this thing is G2. So what do you think? G1 and G2 are same? Because ultimately what I say that two bounding boxes which are off by 2 pixels. So whether they are same? Answer is no. Whenever we want to do these things, we have to also consider that what is the length and breadth of this particular box. Okay, in the detection, this part is also important. So how to inculcate this particular part into the thing? So whenever you are going to create a loss function, you have to also take part of this particular length. So loss functions are actually modified appropriately. So some more details are there. Okay, those are the smaller details that are not technically that much important in terms of the philosophy. So it is fine. We have talked about that there are 8732 number of head that it actually generally applies, and there are other variants also in the paper. Also, he mentions that there are other things. Default box having the large IUU with the ground truth box are trained. Okay, this is a very important line. Okay, once again, let me explain. I have given this idea to you, but let me tell you what I mean by this. What I told you, that images are actually divided into parts, and for every part there is a classification head that is going to do the things. So how many classification heads are there? We have talked about 8732 number of classification heads are there. Let's assume that there is some object. For example, here is an object. Okay. Let's assume here is an object. And I have told you that every classification head is actually responsible for a particular region. So for that particular region, there is a default box. I would tell that this is a default box in this particular region. In the region, default box is this particular region for this particular classifier head. Make sense? But the point is that let's assume this is a ground truth, because when at the time of training, what would happen? So let's assume this is the architecture, but when you start training, what would happen? That there would be an image, and in the image there would be some ground truth that here is a cat, learn first, use system had to learn. So in this particular time, let me just draw like this. In this, let's assume that here is a cat, there is a ground truth. So who is going to train at that, given this image? I cannot modify the things are every of the classification heads. I have to only modify the things for these things which are actually corresponding to this particular area. Na? How can I tell that in this particular area you are actually going to have? So for that, another concept that is called the IOU. I think do you understand IOU? IOU? So if there is one image like this, another image is like this. Let's assume that here are 50 pixel, here are 10 pixel in this particular region, 10 pixel on this particular region, 50 pixels are in this particular region. And let's assume that 30 pixels are in this particular region. Okay, 30 pixel of region. So IOU is what is the common divided by what is total, 10 plus 50 plus 30. I want to find out the maximum value. When it would be maximum? When both the things are actually going to be inside. Okay, then only it would be maximum. So the boxes, so whenever I am going to train something, I pick this particular box and try to find out which one has the higher IOU. Okay, only those are going to be trained. So in this particular case, this and this are going to be trained. They are not going to be trained. Okay. So default boxes having large IOU of the ground truth box are actually used for the training. Loss function combines the localization loss and the confidence loss. Two kind of loss is there. What is this localization loss? localization loss means because so we have understood that let's assume that the right kind of image is when let's assume that when this image is given to me, system has learned and it is going to give me this bounding box. So it is correct. But when into the testing case, whenever a new image is given, maybe the item is here, my system is going to give me this answer. Once again, let me draw here. Let's assume that this is the image at the time of test, and here is an object, here is an object, but my system is going to give me this. Okay, system is going to give me this. So how can I tell that how bad it is? Because loss is going to tell that how bad it is. So I can utilize the IUU from here. That is a localization loss. Localization is not L2. Actually, finding out this place and what is the distance between these two places. Okay, L2 loss is like that. What is the distance between these two coordinate, all the coordinate positions? Because there will be four coordinate positions. So what is the respective distance of these coordinate positions? So this is the localization loss, means whether I am going to have all the corners right or not. Next is the confidence loss. Confidence loss is we use a softmax. Confidence loss means that given the various categories are there, so the probability of that right category should be 1, other should be 0, because initially this may not be the value. So we want to have some kind of changes so that it gives me the right category value also. Make sense? If you want to combine these two things, can you just add? No, because L2 loss and softmax loss, they are at the different scales. How much importance I have to give to the classification loss and localization loss, you have to decide. And therefore, a weighted summation is needed, actually. It is just not the combination of L2 loss and softmax loss. There should be some weight that need to be multiplied, and then the loss function comes to you. And we have also talked about that in this thing, for the goodness, you also have to find out that what is the size of this bounding box, etc. So all these things come to the loss. Non-maximum suppression we have talked about, and we have seen that the number of parameters that we are going to get are actually very large. Means because number of output that is going to be given to me from this particular network is also going to be very large. Why? We have seen that images divided into parts. Let's assume it is M cross N. For everything, how many values is going to be given by my network? P size vector, that tells that what is the probability of all the classes, plus 4, or what is the, in which area it is. So P plus 4 multiplied by M cross N, these many number of things that is going to given to me from my network. Any questions on that? So I think this is sufficient. So I would not, Sir, can you explain why SSD is faster than YOLO again? Okay, so this is why it is faster. The answer is actually cannot be given here. Actually, you must understand that there should be some network architectural changes that actually gives you fast, because ultimately both of them falls into the single category where they are doing the things on the single way. What I think that maybe I'm not sure about this actually, that what happens that maybe it is going to apply, given the image, it is going to apply some kind of scaling. First you have to scale the things, and then he have to apply the SSD, means the single pipeline that gives you the answer. Here also the same thing is happening. Okay, here also the same thing. Actually, this question is very good question. Okay, we have to think about that, why it is happening. So I would also see about this. I have not thought about much on this particular question, but let me give you from my perspective. I just wanted to give this thing that YOLO, given the image, applies a kind of a scale and then applies a pipeline that gives you the answer. Here, given the image, it directly applies. Given image, it multiple heads are there. They are already applied and gives you the answer. Maybe this may be the reason. Because our the network architecture into this thing is more deeper as compared to this, so that we have to see. So otherwise there is no not much reason that why it is very much fast, because you can see that they are comparable. If it is one side things, this is actually the property of neural networks, that it takes longer time into the training, but at the time of testing, it does not take much time. So that's why both the things are going to be very much very fast as compared to the earlier things. But why they are fast? A very tricky question. I have to see this. Okay, I frankly admit. Yeah, you want to say something?
We applied convolutions to detect the larger things in the image. We made it smaller and smaller.
Yes, yes.
But what about the small part which YOLO couldn't detect?
So this is going to be obtained on this particular part only, na? On the complete image. There also in the YOLO, 7x7 things were actually being seen. So this complete image was going to be taken. But here, number of things are actually larger, M cross N. And you can see that number of things that 8732, here 49 output was only there. So I can see the things at the more smaller level.
So grid
is more smaller. Okay.
So can you go to the parameter slide? You said that P is the probability factor, right? So what would be the length of P? Would it be the number of classes or number of classes plus one?
Number of classes plus one. Yeah. So Ruchir, do you understand what I told? So the answer to this particular thing is this, that maybe because he is applying a kind of a scaling, it is taking some time in that, and therefore it is slow. But I'm not sure. I have to see this. Okay. And looks like that looks like it's a reasonable assumption. Okay. But right now I'm not sure about this. Okay. All right. So any more questions? Next thing that I want to talk about is about the 3D CNN. On the technical level, it is an important topic. Otherwise, whatever you have seen earlier, it is very much similar to that only. So you have seen the CNNs, you have seen the CNN architecture, and into the CNN architecture, what happens if you have an image, you have a kernel, you put the kernel over here and you get the one value out of that, okay? What happens, sometimes the output is not only one image. Output is a sequence of images. For example, videos. Whenever you have to process the video, output is a sequence of the things. And when this kind of sequence of the thing is there, what you can do? If you apply a kernel over here, kernel has a size, okay? So you have also seen that if the things which are going to come, for example, if there are 50 things, if there are 50 frames, so the and this kernel is only 5x5, so how many parameter would be there? 5x5 × 50. Okay, because it had to pass to complete depth. But you cannot do this into the videos when the video is coming, because video is very large. And in one shot, you also don't want to detect, because multiple things are happening. Video, the things are changing. Sometimes when, for example, sometimes I'm waving hands, sometimes I'm sitting, sometimes I'm falling, sometimes doing something. So in the complete image, you cannot apply to this particular depth. You have to see to a localized unit only. What is that particular localized unit? You have to come up with some kind of understanding, and you say that maybe this particular depth I'm going to go, okay? And I'm going to see this particular item to this particular depth D, okay? So whenever you are going to apply a kernel, earlier on the single image, you are applying the kernel, that was, for example, 3x3 kernel. 3x3 kernel, if you apply, it is going to be 3x3 × 3. Generally, it is happening now, because when there is an image could be RGB. If it is an RGB image, you can apply like this. If it is a video, for every frame, you have to apply the filter. So the filter would not only apply at this particular location, but also go inside. How much depth, as I talked about, that you have to specify something. And then if you apply the things into this, so by this complete thing, by this complete frames, with, for example, 10 frames, you are going to depth it 10 frames, and this thing, you are going to get one value. One value, okay? You are going to get one value. Am I right? Then what would happen? It would stride. to take a stride. Next item. Then next 10 frames. No. Once again, why you apply one filter? You can apply multiple filters. I'm sorry. Okay, you can apply multiple filters into the previous thing also, that whenever there were an image, you apply 10 filters. So it becomes one image gives you one thing, but 10 filters give you 10 thing. So you get this kind of things where 10 different values you are going to have. So why to apply one filter, second filter, third filter, fourth filter, multiple filters, X number of filters you are going to apply. So by this, you from this particular thing, you are going to get this deck. Is it fine? I think I have done a lot of clutter. Let me just clear it and ask to you. Let me give you once again. This is the video that is coming to me. Let's assume that this is the video coming to me. I have applied a filter that is, for example, 5x5xD. So this is D. From this particular portion, for this particular portion, I got only one plane. For this particular deck, images, I got one plane. But I am not going to apply one such thing. I am going to apply F such filters to get the feature. Okay, clear? So from here, I got F such filters. Next thing would be that after some time, I have to see something another. So because next action is going to happen. So there could be some shift. From here, I would shift to this particular place, and here I would again take the deck. Okay. This deck. This distance is called stride. Stride, if it is one, it would be just adjacent thing. Stride is 10 and D is 5, then you are going to leave some of the frames. Stride is 2, then there would be overlap between the things. So this depends upon your requirement. So how much stride you can have. I have just shown this at the distance, but you can assume the same way. If I apply the same thing here also, I get another feature map from here. Okay, next feature map. And multiple feature map when I'm going to have, I can apply 3D convolution. Again here, different kind of descriptors means, again, now everything is straight line. You can apply the scene and architecture. Some kind of classifiers, some kind of fully connected networks, and find out that what is the final decision. Fine. Any questions on that? Anna? So try to understand this part. This is only the important part that I wanted to tell you. Okay, here if you are clear, then everything would be clear. Okay. This is a images that are going to come. I am going to take 10 such frames, D such frames. And therefore, my filter size should be 5x5xD if it is 5x5. So I'm going to apply F such filters, so I get this kind of feature map. With a stride, again, I can create the same kind of feature map. And I'm going to apply with different kind of feature map. On this feature map, I can apply convolution, I can different layers of convolution, then apply a classifier, then apply a decision based head and find out the final decision. Yeah.
Filter of the F filters will act on all of the 10
things. Correct. Yeah. So this approach is more suitable to video and builds a spatio-temporal features, because now I'm going to see the space also. So there is a database called KTH, that is a human action-based database. 6 actions are there: walking, jogging, running. What is this? There is some mistake. Okay, hand waving, clapping. Okay, bending. I think I'm not sure about this. Okay, so you can see this paper again. There is a reference that sequential deep learning for human action recognition, international workshop on the human behavior understanding, 2011 paper. Okay, it is a something old paper, but but this has proposed the idea first, okay, 3D CNN. So it got the accuracy of 94.39%, okay, on the human action recognition. So earlier this was not like that good. This is 94.39%. So here 3D CNN, I think you understand that what is 3D CNN. So again, what will be the next thing to do? Looks like that when you find out this particular feature, number of multiplications are very large. Okay, because of the number of multiplications, looks like that number of multiplications are very large. Can I do something so that I can get the same kind, similar kind of feature vectors and with using lesser number of multiplications? Can I do something? Next paper that we are going to discuss, 2019 paper, and asymmetric 3D convolution neural network for action recognition. So it is not that much means breakthrough kind of thing, but the idea is only this, that few minutes back we have talked about that when a video was coming to you, you are going to create this kind of thing and then you apply some kind of mechanism to find out what is going to happen. So the next thing could be that you actually, instead of applying various filter, for example, what I did, that I applied F number of filters. Okay. And all of them had D depth. So before that, why don't I get one class one thing available and different F filters would be applied on this thing. Okay. So different F number of filters are applied on this thing. So they can build something like this that they have actually done the multiplication on inside. Do you understand that what I'm telling? One class one filters are actually applied. Okay. One class. So they are not going to get the depth, only one plane. And the F filter that I'm going to apply, they are going to use a different combination of these items with the different weights, and they are going to develop something three dimension out of that. Am I able to tell you or not? So assume that there is a video coming. Assume that this deck for which we are talking about, on this deck, I'm going into the depth, but I'm going to create only multiple such things. And then I'm going to combine them into the different way to come up with the answer. So what happens that all these F filters that actually I was using earlier, all of them were going to do the inside multiplication. Now they need not to do the inside multiplication. They have to combine only this particular part. They can only combine this particular part and give the answer. So the number of computation is actually reduced. This is what the idea is. This idea can further be extended by, if I say that here using this thing, instead of one thing, I can combine them with the different kind of weights. Okay. Maybe different kind of weights I can apply. So maybe on this I can develop some kind of hierarchy also. So this particular paper says that asymmetric convolution neural networks, it tells that whenever video clip is coming to me, I'm going to apply a convolution, max pooling and convolution. So by this, what we get, this thing, then on that thing, it is going to apply a different kind of means, some one class one convolution, some two class, because here what I'm thinking that try to understand only this thing. If you are sure, I can just give you that this is the one class one things, that multiple things are I have obtained from here. Then I'm going to combine them. And make these things. But you can think that all these things are combined of the same size. Na? They are everything, every time they all of them are going to be combined and I'm going to get a feature vector. Somebody is telling that apply 2 class 2 here, somewhere 3 class 3 you apply. And then whatever you get, you can combine and get the result. Just this idea, that weird kind of idea, they are telling that somewhere I'm going to apply 1 class 1, then somebody I'm going to apply the convolution, different 96 convolution, 16 convolution, 64 convolution. So different kind of operation I'm going to apply, then I create the things. Okay. So how much advantage it is going to get is not very much sure. And also this paper has not get very huge advantage in terms of the previous available thing. But this particular paper is more recent paper, 2019 paper. It talks about the human action recognition, and these are the more used important databases that people these days use. If you want to do the human action recognition, you must consider these databases, UCF 101 and HMDB 51. These are the two important databases that you have to use. This database has been collected from YouTube, where 101 actions are there, 13,320 number of videos is there, and this is one database. Another database is HMDB database that has been collected from movie and TV shows and from internet sources. And there are 6849 clips and 51 actions. These are the two more things, because earlier you have seen that there are only 6 actions, but here 101 actions and 51 actions. So this particular architecture was able to achieve 92% on the UCF and 65% on HMDB. And if you see that that is better than the previous state of the art, that's why the paper has been accepted. But this is not that very much good that to the previous one. Previous one maybe 89% or something. I'm not sure about this, but they are very near to this particular value. 65 earlier maybe 63%, and it is 65% like that. But the idea, I hope it is clear to you. The first idea is this, that all these filters, because I have to apply F number of filters, all those filters are going inside and actually doing the multiplication for all these items. But when the second one, the method that told that before that don't apply directly, in between you introduce a particular idea that I'm going to use make 1+1 plane, and then I'm going to combine this into the F different way. So the number of computations are going to be reduced. Second idea is this, that when you are going to create this 1+1, why don't you apply some kind of convolution operation here also? Then you combine this thing to make this particular kind of feature. Make sense? So these are the two kind of papers that I wanted to discuss today. Thank you very much for your attention.